Now, faith is confidence in what we hope for, and assurance about what we do not see. Welcome back to our last lesson in this course that we've called Unshakable Faith. And that, of course, is the opening verse to Hebrews chapter 11. And throughout this chapter, well, first of all, what we're going to do today is kind of a review of previous, 14, 15 weeks. And so we're just going to hit some high points and hoping that this will be a source of encouragement to you and stimulate your memory, and maybe you'll retain some of the lessons that we've gone over together in this study. But I want to point out the fact that there are three really big ideas that run throughout this chapter of Hebrews chapter 11 about the nature of faith. And, you know, we call this the Hall of Fame of the Faithful. And one thing that these heroes had, and one aspect of biblical faith that's really stressed, is great vision. These people are visionaries. And, you know, what is it about vision? We want leaders that have a vision, that can cast a vision, that can sell us on their ideas for the future, for things being better in the future, for doing creative things to solve our problems, to look ahead, and as the book of Hebrews says, to see things that are invisible. And so this idea of looking ahead, of seeing things that are invisible, of having vision is really big. If you'll just get your sheet, get your Bible, and look at Hebrews chapter 11. You notice in this very first verse, it says, kind of a, you know, an operational definition of faith. It says, it's assurance of things we do not see. And then it goes on the very next verse. It says, by faith we understand that the universe was formed at God's command so that what is seen was not made out of what is visible. It says the ultimate reality is not what we can see. And we have a hard time with that. We like to have things that are physical, that we can put our hands on. Things that we can see. We have this old expression, you know, seeing is believing. But the Hebrew writer says behind the things that we can see, there's a bigger reality that we cannot see. It talks about, well, we can't see the future. By faith, Noah, when warned about things not yet seen, that's down in verse 7, things not yet seen, in holy fear, built an ark to save his family. It talks about the lifestyle that Abraham and Sarah lived as nomads living in tents, and that they were content to do this, to live this unsettled, nomadic, in some cases, physically uncomfortable life, because it says he was looking forward to a city with foundations. It talks about how Abraham and his son Isaac, his grandson Jacob, his great-grandson Joseph, that these people lived a life of faith, and at the end of their life, they looked ahead to the future beyond the time when they would no longer be on earth. They said they saw these things and welcomed them from a distance. And so to have an unshakable faith, I used to think it was really cool when I was growing up, Superman, and all these great powers he had. First of all, fantastic strength. He could fly, so he's faster than a speeding bullet. He could leap tall buildings at a single bound. He was stronger than a locomotive. But beyond that, he also had X-ray vision. Get this. And if the bad guys tried to hide inside a building or something, a Superman and his X-ray vision could see them. So we as superheroes of faith are called to develop some of this X-ray vision. You know, to be looking for a country of our own. Not comfort, not being settled in here. You know, this is, we can rejoice in so many things in our life here on earth, but this is not our home. We need to be looking for a home. Moses' parents saw his potential. It said they saw he was no ordinary child. I don't necessarily mean that they found that he was just so beautiful, although most parents think their baby is just so beautiful. But it said they were able to see something in this baby that made them risk their lives to save his life. Then when Moses grew up, it says this about the choice that he made instead of living the life of a wealthy playboy, son of Pharaoh's daughter. It said he regarded disgrace for the sake of Christ as greater value than the treasures of Egypt, because he was looking ahead to his reward. It wasn't like I can look out this window here and see something. It was looking into the future. He was looking ahead to his reward. And then the next verse, by faith he left Egypt, not fearing the king's anger. He persevered because he saw him who is invisible. Now that sounds like an oxymoron. How can you see him who is invisible? And it takes this x-ray vision that we superheroes of faith develop to see God, to see God. It says, Jesus said in the Beatitudes, blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. You know, it's hard to have a pure heart these days. It's hard as you get older, you tend to get more cynical. But Jesus pronounces this blessing on the pure in heart. He said, these are the people that that will see God. And so Moses, you know, he persevered because he could see the invisible God. So this is one of the themes that we see here in this hall of fame of the faithful, is that these people were great visionaries, and we're called upon to have great vision also, to see the unseen. And you know, that's kind of heartwarming. That's kind of inspirational, because we love to hear stories about people who are visionary, who have an idea that they sacrifice to make into a reality. They may have a dream of feeding hungry children, or of teaching people to read, or of conquering a disease, building a great business, coming out with a neat product, becoming a great performer or entertainer, a great athlete representing their country in the Olympics, whatever their vision is. And so this is inspirational. But the question is, are we talking about God's vision or my vision? When we're talking about being a faith visionary, God's vision or my vision? You know, there's a couple of expressions that we run across quite a bit in popular culture that are related, I think, in a kind of a backhanded sort of way. One is this expression we see and we hear sometimes, you've got to have faith. You've got to have faith. And I'm sure people mean a lot of things when they say you've got to have faith. And I don't intend to run down everybody that says that, and sometimes I say it or may have said it, but bear with me here. I think in popular culture, when we say you've got to have faith, they're not talking about the faith of Hebrews 11 where we see an invisible God. I think it means kind of a positive outlook, kind of a hopeful wishing. You know, it's kind of, I'm not going to give up because, you know, I just feel like it's all going to work out in the end. Now, contrast that kind of you got to have faith with the faith that the Hebrew writer in verse 6 talks about. He introduces Enoch, and he said he's somebody that pleased God. And because he pleased God, I'm sure, the Hebrew writer in verse, that he had faith. It says in verse 6, and without faith, it is impossible to please God. Because anyone who comes to him, two things here, must believe that he exists and that he rewards those who earnestly seek him. So the kind of faith that it commends here, the kind of faith that it holds up for us as an example, is a faith that believes in God and that he is a rewarder of those who earnestly seek him. And so you just got to have faith doesn't quite get it. It's a specific kind of faith that this passage encourages us to have. And the second thing in popular culture that's kind of related to this idea of you got to have faith is be true to yourself. Be authentic to your own values. Follow your dreams. Find your passion. And let this be your North Star in life, is to find the true you, the real values that you love, and be true to those values. Don't let anything else influence you from doing what you value, what you want, be true to yourself. Now, compare that with the heroes we read about here in Hebrews chapter 11. I'd like to suggest that their dream and their vision was submitted to God's vision revealed in His verbal communication to them and in His Word. I just don't see that Abel had a dream of worshiping with animal sacrifice. You know, that was the culmination of his life's ambition, was to have this particular kind of worship. I don't see Noah as a 19-year-old when he's proposing to his wife. He says, his future wife, he says, you know, someday I want to build a really big boat. I want to build a really big ship. That's my dream, you know, for myself and my family and lots of animals. That's my dream. Instead, what we find is that Noah was driven to build this boat, it says, by reverent fear or holy fear, obedience to God, submission to God. That's what pushed him. It wasn't his dream. God says, build a boat. So he built it. And the same thing with the nomadic patriarchs, you know, Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, Joseph, the destination out there in the distance. You know, I just don't see Abraham living fairly comfortably there in the ancient metropolis, ancient city of Ur, saying, you know, I just, the song of the open road, I just want to get out there and wander around with sheep and goats and donkeys and, you know, go around from place to place and endure all these extremes of weather, living in a tent. That's my dream. Instead, the way the Bible tells the story is that God told him to go and get started, and I'll tell you when you get there. That's the way that the story is told. I don't think Abraham dreamed about sacrificing his only son. You know, I don't think that was his dream. And he said, you got to submit, Isaac. We're going to be true to me. This is my vision. I want to slit your throat and burn your body. I don't, you know, somehow that doesn't seem Abraham to me. And so the dream that they did have, though, it said these people accepted that they were strangers and exiles and foreigners on earth because they were looking forward to a city whose architect and builder is God. And so the question is, who is the architect and builder of your vision, of your dream? You know, are you willing to be true to his dream, you know, to his kingdom, to his church? And then when we look through related idea, there are three things I wanted to talk about today. I want to talk about great vision, and I wanted to talk, secondly, about great obedience. Great obedience. We isolated these four military leaders from the book of Judges: Gideon, Barak, Samson, and Jephthah. And the Hebrew writer kind of list them in a row, and he says, you know, I don't have time to tell these stories, but you know them from the Old Testament. These guys were great heroes: Gideon, Samson, Barak, and Jephthah. And they all have great moral failures. But the reason that they're elevated to the Faith Hall of Fame, along with all these other folks, is they're really great in this department of obedience, of God saying, you do this, and they did it. And they overcame a lot of personal faults, failures, and shortcomings, and accomplished great, great things for God. You know, the whole subject of obedience is really less popular than it was a generation ago. And I guess there are a couple of reasons for this. Because if you're talking about obedience, you probably got to say at some point, obey what? Okay? So if we talk about obedience to a certain moral standard, the great moral code that Jesus gives us in the Gospels and then is amplified in the writings of the New Testament, we begin to talk about, you know, the standards of sexual morality and honesty and self-sacrifice, these sorts of things, then somebody's going to feel shame and guilt. And we don't want people to feel shame and guilt, and there's almost a parody of Christians in popular culture and movies and TV shows that these are hypocritical people. They like to condemn everybody else for their faults and flaws and addictions and shortcomings, but, you know, secretly they're all pursuing these awful sins on the side anyway. And so we don't want to talk about obedience to moral code. On the other hand, obedience to doctrine, people will view us as hair-splitting Pharisees. Who cares about that doctrine stuff anymore? And the whole idea that we would submit to a certain form of doctrine as being part of our recognizing Jesus as Lord. And that we do this because not because we want to split hairs, not because we want to be, you know, Pharisees and exclusive, but because we love him. And he said, if you love me, you will obey my commands. And so it's an expression of love that we are very meticulous about our vocabulary. We try to call Bible things by Bible names, and about what we teach about salvation and what we teach about worship and what we practice in these areas. We just try to be careful because we love him. And we want to be obedient. And so this sort of obedience is intrinsic to the faith that we read about in this Hebrews 11. It's almost comical. You know, I talk about people buying into God's vision rather than having their own vision. You know, Moses' vision was he was going to be a revolutionary and liberate his people. So he kills an Egyptian. That doesn't go well. He has to run to the Sinai. So he kind of gives up on his dream and he follows sheep around for 40 years. After 40 years, there's this burning bush. And God says, now, Moses, you are mature and I'm ready to use you. Go tell Pharaoh, let my people go. And Moses at this point says, that's not my vision anymore. I don't want to do it. I can't do it. And so there's like this 3-chapter argument between Moses and God. And finally, God says, Moses, just do it. So Moses says, okay, I'll just do it. But it's not like Moses says, this is my vision, and God, I want you to help make it real. God says, this is my vision, Moses, and you're the man for the job. Let's go do it. So it's this idea of submission and obedience to God's will is a real thing in Hebrews 11. So we've got great vision, great obedience, and then something that the Hebrew writer drums again and again that's hard. It's really hard for us to master this, to understand it, to accept it, and that is the concept of delayed fulfillment. The heroes of faith, the people who had unshakable faith, by and large were willing to accept the fact that, you know, that Moses, it said that he regarded, let me just read it exactly like it says here. I don't want to mess it up. It says, he chose to be mistreated along with the people of God rather than to enjoy the fleeting pleasures of sin. He regarded disgrace for the sake of Christ as of greater value than the treasures of Egypt, because he was looking ahead to his reward. Looking ahead to his reward. And so many of these heroes, they didn't get the reward in their lifetime here on earth. Delayed fulfillment of God's promise. 11:6 says, if you're going to please God, you must believe that he exists and that he rewards, there's that word again, rewards those who earnestly seek after him. So I believe in God, and I've been trying to earnestly seek after him, and I check the mailbox day after day. No check arrives. Where is my reward? You know, it's supposed to be like Publisher's Clearinghouse. A van pulls up to the front of your house. They knock on the door, and there's this big cardboard check that has a fabulous amount of money on it. It's like supposed to be like winning the lottery, isn't it? Or at least if it's not wealth, it ought to be my life goes pretty well, you know? My kids are healthy. My grandchildren are healthy. The picket fence around the yard, you know, everything is peachy. And when that doesn't happen, we go back to 11:6 and we read it again. It says, if you're going to please God, you got to do to the believe exists and believe that he rewards those who earnestly seek him. Say, well, I did that. Where's my reward? And so the Hebrew writer is at great pains to let us know that sometimes their reward does not arrive on our schedule. It does not arrive on our schedule. You know, he hits this topic in earlier in the book of Hebrews. And let me review those passages with you right quick. First of all, there's Hebrews chapter 2 and verse 8. And we talked about this some earlier in the course. You may not remember it. But in Hebrews chapter 2, the writer is going over a hard to understand reference from the Old Testament. I believe Psalm 110. And it's a messianic prediction, and he talks about how God will put everything under his feet and everything will be subjected to the Messiah, that the whole universe will be put right. Then the Hebrew writer says something that's very important, just a little phrase there. He said, but we don't see everything now subject to him. It's not that way yet. There's this delayed fulfillment. He said, but we do see Jesus. We do see Jesus. But we don't see everything subjected to him at this point. This idea comes up again in chapter 10 and verse 13. It talks about how Jesus sacrificed once for sins, and now he's sitting down at the right hand of the throne of God. And he's waiting for his enemies to be made his footstool. He's waiting for his enemies to be made his footstool. We're not there yet. We still live in a broken world. We still live in a place where there's hatred and anger and violence. And the Prince of Peace does not control our world. There's disease. There's confusion. There's ignorance. There's sin. The Hebrew writer wants us to know that God is coming. At the conclusion of chapter 10, which this last few verses of chapter 10 is how we began this whole class, and every week, I don't know if you've noticed on your handouts, the footer has come from that conclusion of chapter 10, that we're not of those who shrink back, but those who have faith and are saved. But I'd just like to go back to the end of chapter 10 and talk about the fact that we're not quite there yet. So do not throw away your confidence. It will be, future tense, will be richly rewarded. There's that word again, reward. You need to persevere so that when you have done the will of God, you will receive, future tense, you will receive what he has promised. For in just a little while, he who is coming will come and will not delay. And my righteous one will live by faith. I take no pleasure in the one who shrinks back. But we do not belong to those who shrink back and are destroyed, but to those who have faith and are saved. So I hope you won't throw away your confidence, because it does bring a rich reward. I hope this study of unshakable faith has been a source of encouragement to you. And let me encourage you to continue to look into the pages of the New Testament and see what it teaches you about living a life of faith. God bless you this day.